So I have the pleasure today of introducing Professor Gunther Ullmann, who is currently at the University of Washington and University of California at Irvine. Let me give you a bit of background about Professor Ullmann. I'm going to read from something I had to write about him as head. So Ullmann's notable awards and honors include the 2011 Boettcher Prize. This is a very elite prize awarded once every 5 years by the American Math Society for a notable paper analysis published during the preceding 6 years. In awarding the prize to Ullmann, the AMS cited his fundamental work in inverse problems. The SIAM, the Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics, also awarded Ullmann the Kleinman Prize in 2011, and this is awarded every 2 years for an individual for outstanding research or other contributions that bridge the gap between mathematics and applications. This past year, the AMS awarded Professor Ullmann with the Einstein Public Lecture. This was an annual series of public lectures started in 2005, which was the 100th anniversary of Einstein's wonderful year of 1905. Among his other honors are election to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and a speaker at the International Congress of Mathematicians in 1998 and the SIAM Congress in 2007 and SIAM Fellow in 2010. So it's a pleasure to welcome Gunther.
Thank you very much, Alan, for the very nice introduction. It's a great pleasure to be back here. I gave a talk last year. It was about clocking, and it's more popular, perhaps, topic. And I am looking forward to coming back in September. So what I'm going to talk about today is a couple of problems inverse problems which go under the title of travel time tomography. So let me start with a very general introduction to inverse problems. I hope you can see here. So in direct problems, usually the situation is the following. You know a medium, and you probe it with waves, different kinds of waves, electromagnetic waves, elastic waves, sound waves, and so on. And then you can predict, if you know the medium, the response. Usually this is modeled by some partial differential equations or something like that, but you can predict what's going to happen later. In inverse problems, which arise in all branches of science and technology, the situation is the inverse. You know the wave, you're probing a medium with different kinds of waves, and you know some of the response of the medium to those waves. Perhaps not all, you cannot perhaps measure in all directions, or you know a little bit about the response, and from that information, you try to find what is the medium. So an example that we solve every day of an inverse problem we solve every day is vision. So we see because of reflection in our eyes of the sun or light in general, and the measurements are captured on the film or retina. And this visual processing, and we build three-dimensional images of our surroundings. So this occupies a large percentage of our brain. And the question is, how do we do that? That's a very interesting problem in neuroscience, perhaps. And we don't know how our brain does this in such an immediate way. And we will know more, then maybe we can solve other more complicated inverse problems. And of course, other mammals do the same with different kinds of waves. So a dolphin, for instance, uses sound waves. So sends sound waves and measures the echo of the sound waves and then creates, presumably, an image of what he or she is trying to capture. So the way to find the way around is through sound waves. And of course, sonar was the invention of sonar was based on this principle, sending sound waves. So much higher frequency waves are the examples of bats. Some very high frequency waves, and again measures the echo, and from that tries to find the object that's trying to capture. And this is very much related to ultrasound, these very high frequency waves. And of course there are, again, the picture of the mammal, the dolphin here. Okay, so for instance, the way of probing with this type of waves, acoustic waves, this is the way that the Titanic was found. This is an image sending sound waves from the surface of the sea down, and then they could find it. And seismic imaging, and this is what I'm going to come back to this later in more detail, is a very important economic example of an inverse problem. And most of the oil, we're trying to find oil, is found at sea. And so the usual situation is here, you have this tail, and there are sound guns, guns of sound. So they go to the subsurface of the ocean, and you measure the reflection on the same tail in different hydrophones. And from that, you try to infer this structure. In this case, this is the oil. It's very complicated and very difficult inverse problem. This structure is really complicated. And for instance, the salt domes are very hard to find. So this is a cartoon picture of this situation. Here you have the tail. And here you have the guns. So you send the sound waves, they reflect, and you measure the response on these hydrophones on the tail, and from that you try to find out the structure here. And a very important inverse type of problems are inverse boundary problems, and these arise a lot in medical imaging. And so you're trying to find non-invasive ways of finding the interior of the human body or other medium. And an example is X-ray tomography. So the question is, can you determine the internal properties of a medium by just making measurements outside the medium? You don't want to penetrate. As I said, these are non-invasive methods. So you send an X-ray, this is a very high frequency electromagnetic wave. This is a source of X-rays, a detector of X-rays. These are very high frequency rays. They travel approximately in a straight line. And the question is, can you recover the density from the attenuation of the X-rays? So the propagation here is independent of the medium. This is always approximately in a straight line. But these X-rays are attenuated differently depending on the tissue they interact with. So you move the source around and the detector around, and the question is, can you recover the density or the attenuation from this information, from the attenuation of X-rays? So mathematically, you find what is called the X-ray transform or the radon transform. You find the integral of the density over these rays. So let me give you an analogy, discrete analogy. First, let me mention that this problem was solved in the mathematics literature by Radon in 1917 for complete different reasons. Although X-rays were available at the time, he was not thinking in any application like tomography. And he found a formula to find the a function from its integral along lines. And this formula was rediscovered by Alan Cormack, and he and Hounsfield developed the first tomographs, and they got the Nobel Prize in Medicine for this discovery. This changed completely the practice of medicine. Now you have CT scans that can find a lot about the interior of the human body by making these non-invasive measurements. Still, X-rays are a little harmful to the tissues, but it gives you a lot of information. So to make a discrete analogy, a simple analogy, you have the following Sudoku type of problem. Let's have a square here. Here is your X-ray source. The integral means just the sum of these numbers, 4, 4, and 5 is 13. So here is the detector of the X-rays. You detect 13. You take lines in different directions. You get different numbers. And from that, you try to infer these numbers. The density corresponds to the density in the medium. And so there are different, if you take all the possible lines, this is too much information. So you have 9 unknowns here and 11 linear equations, and you don't want to take too many X-rays because, as I said before, they are ionizing and they can be harmful. So you take a few X-rays, and this is the difference, completely different situation. This is too many equations for the 9 unknowns, and in this case, you're taking less lines. You have 9 unknowns and only 6 equations, so there is some indeterminacy. And this is called partial data or limited angle data problems. You cannot get all the information inside. But the question is, what can you get? So just to give you a formula, I don't want to scare anybody. This is what Radon did in 1917. In dimension 2, this is the source and the detector of X-rays. This is the normal to the line. And Beer's law says that the intensity of the detector compared to the intensity of the source changes in this way. So there is a decay, and F is the density of tissue or the attenuation. So the derivative of the intensity is proportional to the intensity itself times an attenuation factor. So what you have this information. This is what's given to you. And you can measure this, and then you can recover the integral of the function along lines. And so the inverse problem, mathematically, is can you find the function f from the integrals along lines? So the lines are parametrized by the normal to the line and the distance to the origin. So theta is the normal to the line, and s, modulo of s, is the distance to the origin, and you just integrate this function along this line. Again, this is quite mathematical, but I just want to write a beautiful formula that Radon discovered much earlier on than tomography. So this is the information that you have, and this is the formula he found. So in order to recover f, you have to differentiate the data, what you found, and perform this integral, and then average over all possible angles. Of course, in practice, you cannot take all possible X-rays in every direction. You can take only a finite number of them. And the numerical implementation of this formula is called the filter back projection algorithm. And this is what used in every, not in every, but in most CT scans that you find in hospitals. It's a discretization of this formula. This is one example of where pure mathematicians and applied mathematicians should talk more to each other. Radon found this formula in 1917, and the application was not until the 60s. So you can try to classify inverse problems in the following way. So I will call it nonlinear linear inverse problems if there is no scattering. And this is the case of X-rays, approximately. This is always approximately. Here is the source and the detector, and the X-rays travel in a straight line. So the medium is indifferent to the propagation. It's always in a straight lines. And that's why they call them linear. And so X-ray tomography is an example of a linear inverse problem. Positron emission tomography is mathematically exactly the same as X-ray tomography, but here you're putting a radioactive source inside. But it's also a linear inverse problem, and magnetic resonance imaging, where you use a strong magnetic field to measure the water content of tissues. This is also an example of a linear inverse problem. And the mathematics of these three is exactly the same. It's reduced to the study of the X-ray transform or the radon transform. And nonlinear problems are more difficult. There is scattering. In this case, an example is ultrasound. You have here a source and a detector of sound waves. And the waves propagate along a particular path. Here, I'm going to be describing this case in more detail during the talk. This is related to the topic, it's travel time. You will be able to measure the travel time of waves from source to detector. But the propagation here depends on the medium, depends on the index of refraction of the sound speed of the medium. And the question will be, can you recover the medium, the sound speed, or the index of refraction from the travel times? So this is the case of transmission tomography, where the rays are transmitted here, and ultrasound also uses reflection tomography. We'll talk a little bit about that, where you measure the echoes. You send sound waves, very much like in the case of bats, as I said before. You measure the reflection, and from that, you try to infer the inside. And this is, of course, used all the time for pregnant women nowadays. It's a very safe method. And there is another example which in some sense is the opposite of this, of a nonlinear inverse problem, which is electrical impedance tomography. And in this case, you put electrodes around the body, you put voltages, and you measure the induced current flux at the boundary. And from that information, you try to recover electromagnetic property, in this case, electrical conductivity of the material. But this is a very diffuse inverse problem because the currents go all over the place immediately. Here, the propagation is along definite path. So in a very clear way, these are opposite of each other. This is a diffuse inverse problem, and this is very concentrated along a particular path. And this is very useful for high contrast, like in this case, but the resolution is not that good. Ultrasound provides a much better resolution. So we have this type of linear and nonlinear inverse problem. However, there has been a lot of interest in recent years in trying to combine the best of both, of ultrasound, for instance, and electrical impedance tomography, or taking electromagnetic waves going through the body. Ultrasound provides, in general, very high resolution, but not so high contrast, especially to optical properties or electromagnetic properties. But electrical impedance tomography, or optical tomography, which is shining light instead of current, provides very high contrast between healthy and unhealthy tissues, but has not a very high resolution. So you try to combine the best, not the worst, of both. And those are called hybrid methods, and they have received a lot of attention in recent years. So you have a superposition of two images, each obtained with a single wave. Not two ways. It's not that you take ultrasound and you also do EIT and then you compare images. There is only one wave that you use, and you get two images using a physical principle. So ultrasound is very sensitive. The specificity is very high to bulk compressibility. And the optical waves to the electric permittivity, this is the electromagnetic parameter. And this, the combination of ultrasound with optical waves, is what's called photoacoustic imaging. And if you take lower frequency electromagnetic waves that penetrate deeper in the body, you combine that with ultrasound, you try to recover electrical conductivity, how much electricity is being conducted. So this is two examples of hybrid method. And the physical principle that allows you to just use one wave is the photoacoustic effect. And you can, in some sense, call it the sound of light. So when this was discovered by Graham Bell trying to invent wireless communication, this was in the 19th century, of course, before the telephone. So he observed the following physical principle. When rapid pulses of light are incident on a sample of matter, they can absorb. And then the tissues heat in a different way, and the resulting energy will then be radiated as heat. This heat causes expansion, elastic expansion, therefore acoustic waves, because the variation, the pressure has a variation in the surrounding medium. So you can hear, you send light, and you can hear sound. So it's, in some sense, it's lightning and thunder. So this is a cartoon picture of photoacoustic tomography, which is one of the medical, more recent medical imaging techniques that has a good chance of making it to hospitals eventually. You send a laser beam, rapidly varying. Then it's absorbed by the by tissues, and different tissues absorb in different ways. So in particular, healthy tissues and non-healthy tissues have a bit different rate of absorption. This produces thermal expansion, acoustic waves. And what you do is you measure the acoustic wave on the exterior of the medium. And then you try to form an image from that. So this is an example where it doesn't fit into the previous category of linear and nonlinear. In fact, it's a combination of the two. And because here you're trying to combine two different types of waves that give you different type of information. So to give you an example of the kind of things you can do, you can get a very detailed picture of the veins, because these have high contrast in, for instance, in electrical conductivity, but you can also get high resolution, and you can see a melanoma here. This is near the skin. Okay, so now we come to the topic of the lecture, travel time, tomography, and the problem arose in global seismology, in trying to determine the structure of the Earth. We have not been able to realize Julius Verne's dream of going through the center of the Earth. This is one of the science fiction possibilities that has not been realized. And we have two different ways of penetrating deeply into the Earth. One is earthquakes, because those are very strong. They have a long wavelength. They penetrate very deeply. And underground nuclear explosions. Both of them produce a lot of damage, of course. But however, they give you a lot of information about the inner structure of the Earth. So the way to find about the center of the Earth is riding earthquakes. So this is an example of the Magnolia earthquake. It was magnitude 7.1, I believe. And so what you measure is the travel time of seismic waves, and this is measured at different seismic stations around the world. So the unfortunately, my native country, which is Chile, has produced a lot of data in geophysics. The largest earthquake ever recorded was in Chile in 1960. Was in the south of Chile, was 9.5 in the Richter scale. So it completely changed the geography of the south of Chile. And recently, there was almost 3 years ago, there was an earthquake 9.0 in the south of Chile. Of course, you know the earthquake in Japan recently was also 9.0. And this is the tsunami that came from the 1960 earthquake. These are the strongest, largest waves, and you have different colors depending on the magnitude. And it really provoked a lot of damage throughout the Pacific. Okay, at a completely different scale, and already mentioned this, I call it human body seismology, is ultrasound transmission tomography. So you send high-frequency waves. Here this is the transmitter, and here is the receiver. And I said before, first you have a straight line. Here is essentially vacuum, it's air. And the waves will follow certain curves, which I call them gamma here. And you have the receiver, and you measure the travel time. And this is the transmission problem. And the travel time, and this is similar to the radon transform, but now it's non-linear, is the index of refraction, which is 1 over the sound speed, integrated over all along this curve. And you can see that this is non-linearly dependent on the sound speed that you're trying to recover, because the curve gamma depends on the sound speed. So this is the time of flight. So the question is, from the time of flight, can you recover the index of refraction? This is a very important problem. And still there are some open questions, but I will tell you what we know about this problem. This has been used in practice in medical imaging. I hope this comes out. Here is the breast. I don't know whether the resolution is not so good. This is for breast imaging. The woman is lying on top. The breast will lie here. You send sound waves from one side to the other, and from that you try to find whether there is cancer or not. This uses ultrasound transmission tomography. For some reason, I cannot move this. And then this. Okay, so talking about the ultrasound, as I said before, I'm going to describe a little bit more precisely one of the problems I mentioned before. These are images from ultrasound trying to detect breast cancer. This is a very difficult problem because ultrasound doesn't have a good contrast to breast cancer, particularly in younger women in soft tissues. And it's very hard to pick up. Of course, the radiologists are trained to see the difference and so on, but from these pictures, it's very hard to predict. So it has good sensitivity, but very bad specificity. And so this is why photoacoustic tomography has been developed once more. Is it my... So again, this is the photoacoustic effect. You send a laser pulse, a rapidly varying laser pulse, and generates an acoustic wave, and you measure what you measure is the acoustic wave. So the mathematical model for this is as follows. In photoacoustic tomography and thermoacoustic tomography, is you take the pressure satisfies the wave equation. This is time and space. Sound, C is the sound speed. And then you have the thermal absorption. This is a coupling constant, H, inside the body that you are trying to find. Okay, so this is a mathematical model. I'm not going to talk more about this. This is a linear problem depending on the initial condition, which is also a source. You can think of this as the source of heat. Okay, so once you have solved this problem, this is linear, so it falls into the first category of inverse problems. You recover this internal information. You're making measurements just at the boundary. So you're measuring the pressure at the boundary of the object across some, for some interval of time, but you get information about the inside. That's the thermal absorption of the different tissues. And different tissues have different absorption. In particular, there is a high contrast between healthy and unhealthy tissues. And the second step is to reconstruct the optical or electrical properties. You don't want the thermal expansion. You want the conductivity, or you want the absorption and so on, rather than these quantities. So the second step is to recover those optical properties or electrical properties from this thermal absorption that you have found in the first step. And this is a nonlinear inverse problem. However, the advantage now is that you have internal information. You know H inside. So for measurements on the outside, you have gotten some information inside, and now you, which is not exactly what you want, but once you have that, then you try to recover the information that you need, like the optical and electrical properties. But this model assumes that you know the sound speed, and a lot of the time you don't know it. Most of the time you don't know it. And all of these problems are very sensitive because what the acoustic wave that you measure, there is an acoustic wave, but the but is very small. So you don't want to make too many errors in the sound speed because this will affect your reconstruction. So the problem is, how do you reconstruct the sound speed? And then you use ultrasound transmission tomography. You do the travel time that I mentioned before. So this is the other application of travel time tomography, is to photoacoustic tomography itself. At first, you reconstruct the sound speed. Then you reconstruct the thermal expansion, and then finally the optical or electrical properties of the material. So you have to solve three inverse problems, but they are all not so ill-conditioned inverse problems. And this was proposed by the group of Li Hong Wan. So, and another motivation, this is the last one I will mention, is there are many others, is in ocean acoustic tomography, because the temperatures in the ocean are correlated with travel time. So that's the way they measure large deviations of temperature in the ocean, by taking, by sending sound and measure the travel time. And for instance, global warming and the increases temperature in the oceans is found this way. This was from the web page of the Wood Hall Oceanography Institution. It was the first, as far as we know, experiment to determine the sound speed of water. Just ring a bell, you measure the echo, and then you can determine the speed. It's very simple. Okay, so the examples I mentioned before are all transmission tomography. You look at the transmission of the waves, but of course many inverse problems are also in this category, involve reflections. So let me mention two cases when there is a lot of scattering points in the medium. That means there are a lot of discontinuities in the medium. Then the rays will reflect. So this is when now the travel time will be the sum of the travel times of the incident and reflected wave. And when you have an obstacle, here is the same type of situation. You have a reflection here. This is a combination of the two. This is transmitted, and this is reflected. And of course, reflection tomography is the case of oil exploration that I mentioned previously, and also ultrasound, not transmission ultrasound, but reflection ultrasound. You measure the echoes produced by the medium. But here you have a lot of discontinuities. Okay, so now let me go a little bit more into the mathematics. I hope it's not too technical. So as I said before, the motivation is to determine the inner structure of the Earth by measuring the travel times of sound waves. And this problem was considered very early on by Herglock, mathematician, in 1905, and a little bit later by two geophysicists, Wicker and Soffritz. And they assumed that the Earth was spherically symmetric. So the sound speed depends only on the radius. And also they assume this condition that looks very strange, that the radius over the sound speed is an increasing function. And so in some sense, there are no regions of low velocity inside the medium. And we're going to see why you need a condition of this type. Okay, and what you measure is the travel time once more. This is the curve gamma in this case. And you measure the travel time. But now let me address what are these curves of propagation gamma. So this is based on the ray theory of light and Fermat's principle. So light takes the shortest optical path from A to B. It's not, in this particular case, where the index of refraction is varying from low to high, is not a straight line between A and B, but this curve here. And this will be the geodesic of some metric. And this depends on the index of refraction or the sound speed. And the geodesics are curves that try to minimize locally distance, try to minimize the time. The waves are trying to minimize the time to go from point A to point B. So these curves are geodesics of a certain metric. And what is the metric in the case of Herglock and Wicker and Soffritz is this one. It's just a multiple of the standard metric. If you're not familiar with metrics, you just think of this as just a function. So when you're measuring length, this is measuring length. Of course, it's inverse proportional to the speed. The larger the speed, the smaller the length. Okay. But that's in the case that you have this assumption that the sound speed depends only on the radius. More generally, this is, of course, not realized in practice. The sound speed usually is very heterogeneous. So the sound speed depends on position, and the velocity in this case is independent of direction. This corresponds to the isotropic case. So the velocity is independent of direction. However, there are many mediums that are anisotropic. For instance, in the human body, muscle tissue is very anisotropic. Crystals are very anisotropic. And it has been found that the inner core of the Earth is anisotropic, with the fastest direction of propagation and the direction of rotation of the Earth. So to model this, the length now will not be just a multiple of the standard length, but will depend on a matrix. So it will depend on direction. I and J is different in different directions. And this is a positive definite symmetric matrix, which is called a Riemannian metric in differential geometry. And now the velocity depends on direction. And it's given by this, where this is the inverse of these metrics. So these are the rays of propagation. They are geodesics. They try to minimize length. And I'm going to describe a little bit more what length is. So the information about travel time is encoded in what's called the boundary distance function. So for the geometers here, let me say that you, it's useful to consider the problem in more general setting. You can look at a Riemannian manifold with boundary, but for the people who don't know, just think of a domain with a positive definite symmetric matrix that corresponds to the anisotropic index of refraction. And what are we going to measure? The travel time, trying to go from point X and point Y in the minimum amount of time possible. So what you're measuring is the distance function between two points in the boundary with respect to this metric. And that's the infimum of the length of all curves. This is Fermat's principle, joining all the curves, for all the curves joining the two points X and Y. And this is the length of the curve, and it's independent of the parametrization that you use. This is the curve sigma, and the square root of the length of every tangent vector to the curve. And now I can set up the inverse problem rigorously. Can you recover the metric, this matrix here, knowing this distance function? This is the first arrival time of waves. If you measure it for every point x and y on the boundary. Of course, this is an idealized problem, and if you want to do it in practice, you have to take a finite number of measurements and so on. So can you do this? Of course, as I said before, this problem arose in geophysics a long time ago. In mathematics, it's called the boundary rigidity problem. And the answer is no. You cannot recover. You have a change of variables, a diffeomorphism, which leaves the boundary fixed, for instance, a rotation inside. Then the distance function of a new metric, or a new matrix, which is formed from this, is called the pullback, is the same as the distance function of the metric G. And what is this? This is, in terms of matrices, this is the matrix of the differential of psi, the Jacobian, composed with G, composed with the transpose. And this is clearly geometrically because the length is not going to change by change of variables. And you can see it clearly here. If you take, this is the length of the curves joining the two points. If you change the curve by this change of variables, you apply the chain rule here, and you're going to get that the length of the new curve is the same. And the points x and y have not changed. So you have this large number of metrics that give you exactly the same information. You take any change of variables that leave the boundary fixed that gives rise to a new metric, a new anisotropic velocity that gives you exactly the same information. So this seems like bad news. However, in practice, you usually know more information about the velocity or the index of refraction that you're trying to recover. So you put some that a priori information in, and you can find what is the change of variable. But it's important to know whether this is the only obstruction, whether that's all the possible metrics that have the same information are given by some change of variables in this form. And unfortunately, again, and this is related to the condition of Herglos and Wicker and Soffres, the answer is no. You cannot recover. It's very simple to see. Suppose you have a point x0 where the velocity is very low. That means the matrix is very large. Remember, the metric and the velocity are the inverses of each other. Then the curves that you are going to use to minimize the distance between two different points are not going to go through this point because that will take a long time. The distance will be too large because the metric is too large here, the velocity very low. And so you're going to go around and you're not going to be able to see anything at all about what's happening near the point x0, nor the topology, nor nothing. So this is why Wicker and Soffres and Herglos were imposing this condition that the radius over the sound speed is increasing to avoid this situation. And mathematically, this just means you have to have a point with very large distance to the boundary. And another example is this. I have been trying for a long time to get the point that the South Pole should go, be up, because I'm from the Southern Hemisphere originally. And in all the maps, you always have to look, up. And it's time that the people from the Northern Hemisphere do the same. So this is, you can see interesting maps of how the world will look upside down. It's completely different. So take this situation. Here the geodesics are big circles. This is the propagation that you take when you go on planes usually. But if you increase the metric a little bit around the South Pole, you're not going to go through this geodesic, you're going to go along the equator. This takes much less time. And you can change the metric near here, and you cannot find it from the distance function. And so the question is, what is the condition that we need in order to guarantee that this is the only obstruction? In some sense, this is a uniqueness. By the way, this was used in the Second World War, the fact that the rays will avoid the regions of low velocity to hide submarines. The submarines have sensors that determine the depth and the temperature. And as I mentioned before, the temperature is correlated with the sound speed. So, of course, this was a very ad hoc method. They will go into regions of low velocity because most of the rays will avoid that region. And that way you will hide the submarines from sonar. And this is a very interesting article on how to use tomography to find out about, this is another very interesting topic, the ocean's secret. Okay, so since we know that you cannot recover, in mathematics we give a definition for that. It's called, then a metric is called boundary rigid. If you have another metric that satisfies, that has the same distance function, then is the pullback of each other by change of variables, which is the identity of the boundary. And so you need an a priori condition. This is what Herglotz and Wicker and Sophist had for the manifold, for the metric to be boundary rigid. Let me mention just mathematically, there's a condition called simplicity. So a manifold is simple. If given two points in the boundary, there exists a unique minimizing geodesic joining the two points, and the boundary is strictly convex. So you, like in the case of the sphere, there are many big circles that go through the South Pole. So there is not a unique minimizing geodesic in that case. You want to avoid that situation. And the boundary strictly convex means two points in the boundary, the geodesic joining them stays inside. It's convex. Also, this means, in other words to say, is that the geodesics are not just locally minimizing. Geodesics minimize locally time to go from point to another point, but globally, because there is a unique geodesic and it's minimizing. And the conjecture is that if the manifold is simple under this condition, and I repeat, this replaces the Herglotz and Wicker and Sophist condition, then the manifold is boundary rigid. Okay, and this was proposed in the mathematical literature in this way, formally in this way, but of course this has been around in the geophysics literature for many years. So there are several results obtained about boundary rigidity, compacts as domains of the Euclidean space or hyperbolic plane, and let me go quickly over this, compacts as domains of Euclidean space, negatively curved symmetric spaces. These are all conditions on the metric. They have constant curvature. And with this some work in 98 that was generalized in 2003 and the further results in 2010 that tells you if this metric is close a priori to the Euclidean metric, meaning to the standard metric in flat metric, where the geodesics are just straight lines, then you can solve this problem. In dimension two, it was known for negative curvature, and I proved a result with Leonid Peltov that in two dimensions, this is true. The distance function recovers the metric up to the natural obstruction, solving the conjecture in two dimensions. And we have recently proved the conjecture in higher dimensions, but with a different condition and simplicity, which is much more analog to the condition of Hergloss and Wicker and Soffrit. So you have two metrics, and this manifold is foliated. It means you can exhaust the manifold by these strictly convex hypersurfaces. Then if the distance is the same, then the metrics are the same up to this isometry. And the method is constructive, and I will tell you a little bit about this. And the condition of this foliation by strictly convex hypersurfaces is, for the people who know these words, the level sets of a function are strictly convex with respect to the metric. If you take what's called the Hamiltonian vector field square, and you take with twice, you apply it twice to a function, this is strictly positive for the directions which are tangent to the surf level sets F equal to constant. So you need some condition, and this is exactly the analog of the Hergloss and Wicker and Soffrit condition. In fact, it's the same. Is the sound speed depends only on the radius. And so the method is constructive and is actually based on a local construction. So what we solve actually is a problem which is of interest in geophysics, because you don't have information for all around the Earth. That's very difficult, in fact, impossible to obtain. You only have partial information. So let's say you have an open subset of the boundary, and this can be as small as you want. And you only know the distance function between two points, x and y, let's say, that are in this open set. So you know only the travel time for these geodesics. Then the theorem is that you can recover constructively the metric locally near this boundary. And so if you do this, and you can foliate your manifold, or this open set, by strictly convex surfaces, you can keep going until you exhaust the whole manifold. And this is the way you do it. It's sort of what's called a layer stripping type of algorithm. You go layer by layer, constructing the sound speed. How much time do I have? It's already over the hour?
No,
okay. Okay, let me finish quickly. You're mentioning here the first arrival time of waves, but in seismic imaging and other problems, you have information about multiple arrival times. And the question is, can we use that multiple arrival times? Because the first arrival time is the first peak. This is the first thing that you see, but you cannot recover. We need some a priori condition that we don't know if it is satisfied or not a priori. So what you have to do is follow not just the minimizing geodesic, you have to follow all the geodesics. And how do you encode that information? So let me go very quickly over Hamiltonian mechanics here. Suppose you have this symmetric positive definite matrix. Again, take the inverse. You define the Hamiltonian. This is the length of the vector C in this metric G. And I put this so that this Hg equal to 0 means the length of the vector is 1. And you take what's called the bicharacteristics. I'm sure in other fields they're called differently, or these are the rays. So you take Hamiltonian vector field, which is the derivative of this with respect to C, already mentioned this vector field, and minus the derivative with respect to X. So you go to phase space. because you want to consider points and directions. And you solve this system of ordinary differential equations. So you know the initial point and the initial direction. And this is of length 1. This means hg is equal to 0, the length of the vector c is 1. And the geodesics, this is the Hamilton way of looking at geodesics, are simply the projections from phase space of these bicharacteristic curves to x. So this part of the, this is a very convenient way of thinking about geodesics. So here is an example of geodesics starting at a point with different directions, and you see that some geodesics will go through the humps. We are going to assume that there is non-trapping, meaning there are geodesics that you don't want to have geodesics stay there forever because you cannot recover any information. But that's it. That's all the information. That's all the information that we will need. And so the inverse problem is encoded in what's called the scattering relation. So again, we need to look at the behavior of all the geodesics, not the ones that just minimize length globally. Of course, geodesics minimize length locally. So you take a point and a direction of the geodesic, you follow it, assume that it gets out, and you look at the point where it exits and the direction in which exits. So this is a map sending the initial point and initial direction to the final point and the final direction. And this is called the scattering relation. So if we know the direction and the point of entrance of the geodesic, we know the direction and point of exit. And sometimes you add the travel time, meaning the length of this curve. But the problem is both without this condition. So can you recover the metric from the scattering relation? It's called scattering relation because it comes from the scattering operator. I'm not going to go into the details of that. You look at the singularities of the scattering operator are concentrated along these geodesics. And the conjecture is that if you have a non-trapping manifold, then the scattering relation, which has much more information now, determines the metric G. And you don't need this simplicity condition or the Herglotz-Wicker and surface condition. And what we did with Pestov in dimension 2 was to connect this scattering relation with another inverse problem that I won't have time to describe called the Dirichlet-Neumann map. This is a case of electrical impedance tomography. And you put electrodes around and you measure the induced current flux. So you connect a travel time problem with a problem involving electrical measurements. But let me also mention that if the manifold is simple, then the scattering relation does not give you any new information. So we know very little about the scattering relation. And for the young people here, this is a very simple problem to state. Can you recover a metric if you know the scattering relation, point and direction of entrance and point and direction of exit? Can you find the metric inside? A very natural inverse problem, very geometric, but new ideas are needed for this. Okay, so let me finish here. It's time, right? Or?
Yes. Okay, thank you, Gunther. First of all, any questions? Oh, yes.
I have a microphone.
You have your questions prepared.
I mean, repeat that. Actually, I guess if you want to measure the travel time, you have to use a pulse before. And so the pulse typically would have more than one frequency there. So is there an interesting assumption that the speed of the wave is not dependent on
the
frequency?
Yeah, here the assumption is, it's a good point, the assumption is that the medium is not lossy. So the speed is not dependent on frequency. Even with that, we have a lot of problems already. Yeah.
And I suppose that the medium cannot be
For fixed frequency, it's fine. I mean, for fixed frequency, it's fine, right? But if you vary the frequency, then it's, if the median is lossy. But for very low frequencies, like seismic waves and so on, this is OK, because these are very high, very low frequency waves.
And I suppose that the medium cannot have too many strong scatterers inside, otherwise the wave will just bang itself many times and it will get lost before.
That's right. Yeah, this is another thing that I was going to mention, but I didn't have time, the case. If you have scattering points, actually it's useful. Useful. It's not the opposite. This is, let me mention, actually I was too optimistic about how much I will cover. Here is this, the case of reflection is much better. You have a scattering point to help you because you have the travel time of the reflected wave. So suppose you have that information. For any point x0, c0, you have the information of what's called the broken, the travel time of the broken ray. Then you can recover the metric without any condition. You don't need simplicity or anything. The case of reflection is easier than the case of transmission. But of course, for this, it means that you have to have a lot of scattering points in the medium to be able to recover this information. So by the way, one of our motivations, just for you, for invisibility, was exactly this this point that I made before. Oh, sorry, I passed it. This one. If the metric is too high, you can hide something inside. So of course you have to, this is true for the rays, but you have to do it for the waves. And that's what we had this, this blow up of the metric. But this was the motivation for it. So this is what was used in the Second World War to hide submarines, this principle. Yes? Yeah. Yeah, right, right. This is a high frequency approximation of the waves. If you want to, if you have the sharp fronts, that means discontinuities of the medium, then you have reflection. You have reflection and transmission too. And so you can use the information from the reflected waves. This is the question that, I think this is the question that C.T. Chan asked me. So you have discontinuities, actually that gives you more information. No, Fermat's principle is valid, but for the rays that will produce are not these geodesics, straight geodesics going from two points. You will have Snell's law, things like that, right? If the change of in the index of refraction changes. Of course, the principle is the same, but the curves that you have to take are, they will have to break. And those are the reflections, the Snell's law.
Let me ask a layman's question.
Yes, please.
So the sound go faster in cold water or hot water?
What do you think?
I would imagine faster in cold water, but probably not.
No, it's true.
So you should hide in hot water.
You should hide in, I don't remember whether it's correlated to 1/1 the sound speed or to the sound speed itself. So I don't know actually the answer to that.
Okay, let me ask another thing. When you tried, I mean, this is, you've been talking about theoretical, but when for actual application, you have to discretize all this.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, how many points are you talking about?
Oh, there's not, actually, has some numerical experiments. Again, I was too ambitious. We have a method of reconstruction. and some numerical examples. And you don't need that many many points, but you need to do a lot of iterations to use this layer stripping type of algorithm. For instance, an example, which is, there is a good example in geophysics, which is called the Marmoussi model, which is a benchmark. I mean, you can always say your algorithm is better than the other one and so on, but there is a benchmark algorithm, very complicated one, called Marmoussi model. It has a lot of structure, very complicated structure. This is certainly not simple. And just using travel time, you can get pretty good pictures with this type of theoretical method, not using that many points. They're doing a lot of iterations in the, because you have to do this layer stripping type of, you have to go near the boundary and penetrate further and further. And this is with, even with noise. Okay.
Okay, other questions? Okay, then if there are no more questions, let's thank Gunther for a very interesting talk.